your this thing, and what is that? Jupyter, and upload the notebook. The notebook name is DataFrame underscore basics. Now, very important point, I think in the last class we struggled. Ensure your interpreter is PySpark here. It will be Python for some of you, then it will not work. Yeah, Python means it will run using Python. It won't use Spark at all. You write a Python code, it will execute using Python libraries. It won't even talk to Spark. You will get errors then. It will say, I don't know what you're talking about, because it is just this thing, right? This is actually communicating with whatever is behind the scenes. It is like a web UI, right? So if you select the PySpark interpreter, then only Spark it will invoke. If I say Python, you say 1 plus 2, Python will add 1 and 2. Python program will add. No Spark libraries will be invoked. So you will get error saying that I can't find the library, this, that, and all. Okay, so getting started with the data frame. And the first and the most interesting point is that if you have JSON data, so many applications are producing JSON data. JSON is very common, right? So this people.json is nothing. It's not a very complicated file. I'll give you a complicated file later. So if you open this people.json, it is a very simple JSON file. It's not a complicated file. I'll give you a complicated one. Now, the beauty of Spark SQL is there is a read API for JSON, which means if you give a JSON file, it can directly read and create a structure out of it. But again, you have to be careful. What it does, it will read the key as your column name. So it will create a column called name. The value will be Michael. And again, there will be a column called name. I mean, same column, Andy will be there. For age here, you will end up having null values because you don't have anything here, right? Because it is automatically inferring your schema, right? But the advantage is, if I have a JSON file, I can directly say read it. You don't have to do anything special. So if you just scroll down here, first thing we are doing is from PySpark SQL, we'll import the Spark session. Remember Spark session? That's the entry point to Spark SQL library. Let me see if this will work, because in some of the notebooks, it could have already created this Spark session. So it will throw an error saying that, hey, I can't create Spark session. That's fine. So here you are saying that from PySpark SQL, see, there is an error for me. So what this error actually says that it is already running, so it cannot create it. Okay, that's fine. If you get this error, it is fine. But if you are writing your own program, let's say, not the notebook, this is how you start. You will first import the Spark session. Then there is something called Spark session builder. You can give a name for your application. And then you can call this method called get or create. Okay. So now my Spark session is already running here. And if you want to create a data frame, let me just clear this output. Okay. If you want to create a data frame, it's very easy. All you need to do is this. You can simply say spark.read.json and then give your path. So in my case, the data is in datasets, people.json. And if you want to see the data frame, you can say df.show. So this is your data frame. And I think you might be familiar with this in your Python class, right? The same name column structure. So spark.read is a method, and there is spark.read.json, spark.read.csv, spark.read.parquet. So directly you can read, you don't need any third party tools. But when you are actually loading XML files, right, if you want to read XML file, you cannot say spark.read.xml. It will not work. Why? Because XML file has a different structure. Who works with XML? I work with XML. Yeah. You have a root tag, then row tag, and so all this you have to mention. So we have a third party package using that you can read XML. But if you want JSON or CSV or something, you say read, it will read by default. But XML, there is multiple levels actually, right? JSON also you can create, nested key value pairs you can create, but by default XML support is not there. You have to use a Databricks package to read and then create an XML. I'll show you. But make sure you can create this data frame. Anybody who is not able to do it? Two important points here. First, the name of your data frame is DF in this example. It can be anything, doesn't matter. Second thing, here when you use this method, there is automatic schema inference. Meaning, you are not saying what is what schema. Spark will take a best guess and apply the schema. If you want, you can create your own schema. So let's say I want to read this JSON, but I want this column to be date or something, string actually, imagine, okay. So that means you can create your own schema and tell Spark that, hey, when you read, don't just infer the schema, I'll give you the schema. You apply that schema. So by default, it will not do it. By default, if you call this method, it's automatically inferring all the schema. And most of the cases, this is sufficient. It can understand your data. A data frame looks like a table actually, right? A data frame is like a row and column. And another important point is, you see each row, right? Each row is called a row object. It is not a table. So one common confusion is a data frame is never a table, okay? Each row is an object. Actually, internally it stores as an object, okay? And I will talk more about this when we come to data sets, like how each row can be accessed and all these things. But understand, columned values and row by row, it is storing object, object, object.
Each row is a row.
Row object. So it's called a row object, actually. But there is a catch here. Maybe some of you will understand, some of you may not understand. What will happen? Let's say you try to access this value, right? There is no value here. So what should happen ideally? I want to access this value. You will get an error. You will get an exception, right? Because there is no value here. But the problem is, in data frame, it knows that you have three columns. And each column has some data. So let's say you wrote your data frame SQL queries and all, you compiled it and run it, okay? You will get an exception only while running. You will get only runtime exception. And that is bad. Because if you have like 70 columns of data, let's say in one column some values are missing, you wrote a SQL query, and if you run the SQL query, that's what I'm saying, if you type the SQL query, okay, it will say everything is fine. It won't say anything. But when you package and actually execute it, okay, when it actually reads the whole data and try to, you will get a runtime exception saying that, okay, there is a problem. That is where data sets are efficient. If you create something called a data set, okay, it looks exactly like same. There is no difference. You'll have columns and rows and everything. But when I'm actually coding my steps in the shell, I'm saying, the shell, if I just write access this value, even before executing, it will say that don't run. It will give me a compile time error, not a runtime error. It will say that there is no value here. Don't compile this code. So that is the major difference in data set and data frame. We'll see what is a data set later. Okay. So data sets are very new, and Spark has started using it now only, and people will slowly migrate to that. So that is because in data set, each row will have your own schema attached. It will not be like a row object. You can write a schema, proper schema, and say that attached to every row. It will internally encode and store it. It knows in each field what is there. So it knows there is a null. So if you write a select on this, before actually running, it will say, you have a boss, you have a null, don't compile me. Okay, I will throw an error, please correct it. This is just an example. Null, or if let's say something missing, nothing is there, you want to access, you end up in an error. So where will you troubleshoot? That is a question, right? So if I get a runtime error or a compile time error, which is better? The better one is compile time error, right? So because the internal structure is stored in a data set, in a data frame, it never stores. It just assumes these many rows are there. It never knows what is inside the row, right? So here, if I access null, I'll get an error, right? It will give me an exception. So I just want to be aware that if I run my code, I should not get an exception. A lot of people, what they do, they don't take care of nulls. They just say read and create. They don't really care whether it is nullable or not, right? And then when you actually run, then you start getting exceptions saying that I don't find a value here or there. So that time when you create a data set, it can actually, even before compiling, compilation time, I can say that these values are nulls or data type mismatch maybe. Something else, not even null, data types mismatch, right? So those kind of exceptions you can easily handle in data sets. But the problem is, I have not seen people actually using data sets these days. It's very new. Data sets came in Spark 2, okay, it's very popular, but people are still using data frames only. Probably they are more comfortable doing this. I don't know what is the reason. It comes more or less like in an alphabetical manner. Okay, you can switch it and save it if you want, but the structure comes like this. The JSON actually has name and age, but column names are projected like this. That is where you might want to apply your own schema. You want to say that I don't want this, I want first column as name. Either you can write a query and extract the column and create another data frame, or you can say I'll create my schema where the first column I want this, second column I want this, then it will create like that. So here it will automatically decide age and name. You don't have a control on that actually, right? Now once you have a data frame, you can just print the schema. So there is a command called print schema, and this shows that there is an age column and a name column. Okay, age is long and name is string. These are the data types associated. So here you have nullable true right now, right? Null values are true. This you can also have nullable false. You can change it. Okay, so and you can simply say df.columns. It will just show you what are the columns you have, right? And there is also a describe command. So describe command is very much like you are describing a table. It says data frame summary string age string name like this. When you call a describe, it is like as good as collecting the statistics. So in SQL you have this table statistics, right, where you collect information about the team. So when you call a describe, actually what is happening is it'll actually summarize whatever you have in a data frame. And then if you do a df.describe.show, what it has collected, it will look at here. For example, age 2, the mean is this, standard deviation is this, min is max. So wherever possible, it will calculate. So this is useful if you are running aggregate queries and all on the data frame. Because once you describe these values, it will find useful information from this column. So this is like you do table level statistics, right? How do you say you table dot generate statistics you do, right? So very similar to that, if you do a describe, it will attach a column and it will say that these are the summary of the tables, interesting field summary. If you want, you can do it this. We don't actually use this describe and all. I mean, because describe method and all came long back actually, right? So now you don't have to run this method in 2.2 and 2.3, because every data that you are storing, it will already analyze. Like whether, say for example, you are storing gender column. So gender column usually has male and female. Or let's say not applicable, so only three values are there. So you can actually choose to encode that column in a data set. You can say that instead of male, store it as 1. Instead of female, store it as 0. So you are actually reducing a lot of data in that column, right? If I store it as string, I'm taking a lot of data. So these kind of statistics are not, you don't actually run describe these days. These encoding techniques are there now on data sets, which can store your data like instead of a male store as 1 and female it is run as 0. So the column values are much, much reduced. So are you able to do till this, till the describe? Yes, right? Okay, now some data types make it easier to infer schema like tabular formats and CSV. However, you often have to set the schema yourself if you are in dealing with a dot read method. So what we are trying to discuss here is if you are getting a proper JSON file or a CSV file, you can simply say read, it will create a data frame because you have rows and columns. Now what if you do not have a proper structure to your data? Then how do you read the data, right? That time you can apply your own schema to the data, right? And to do that, we have a data type called a struct. Have you heard about struct anywhere else? In SQL you have, right? RDBMS, have you used struct data type? Not in Spark. Like struct is a data type where you can have multiple values. Within one struct, you can have multiple types. And then you can say dot, dot, dot and access it. Say for example, you want to store your address. So address will be like house name, then what, city, then street, then state. I can store this entire thing in struct. Okay. Then I can say I want to access only my city. So I can say A dot city, it will give me only the city from the struct. Something like that. Okay. So that is the original struct. I have used it in Java. Okay. Long back, not now. From that, they have created this struct data type in Spark. This is a data type. So what I'm saying that import struct field, this is general. Within that, I want string type and integer type. Whichever data types you have, there is a type, like there is a float type, integer type. Okay, so I am importing this so that I want to represent my schema, right? So first thing is that we import this data types to represent our data. And next, what you need to do is, okay, you will create your schema. You will say struct field. You will say age. I want a column called age, that is integer type, nullable true. I want another column called name, that is string type, again nullable 2. So this is your schema, actual schema. Okay, struct will hold everything in one kind of like a container. So that is a struct field. You are saying that these are the fields I want. There is one thing called age, that is integer type. Another is called a name, that is string type. So this is each field you are representing, or each column. Struct field is a wrapper like thing. Okay, inside that you are saying I want an integer type column, I want a string type column. So you have created two columns here. So this is like your schema that you are defining. Okay, and then you will create something called a final structure. This is optional. You will say struct types, and here you have fields equal to data schema. You are saying that use these fields I have defined here as my final structure. And then in the same JSON read, you say spark.read.json. You will say read the JSON, comma, you will say schema equal to this schema. So what is going to happen? Your own schema will get applied here, right? Now, actually in, I think in Python also it is there. There are two ways to attach schema. One is using this struct type, okay? Apart from this struct type, do you remember in that captain example? Named tuple, right? You can also use named tuple, but the drawback is if my memory is correct, named tuple can have only 22 or 23 columns max in the schema. So if you want bigger number of columns, you have to always use struct type. Struct type will support as many columns as you want. Like you have a very large table, right? In Scala, it is called a case class. You don't have a named tuple in Scala. So if I'm creating a Scala program and I want to attach my own schema like the captain object, right? I don't have a named tuple in Scala. Named tuple is only in Python. I'll create something called a case class. Very similar, idea only, right? So then you will say attach the schema and print the schema. So I'll just run this. Yeah. So now it is coming with whatever schema that you have attached. Right, you can see df.print schema. Again, the same schema we have given, there is no difference. But I just want to show you that this is possible to attach your own schema. And you can actually refer the Spark documentation. So if you don't believe what I'm saying, right? So I'll show you in the documentation. Older versions 2.2. There is a Spark SQL data frames and data sets. Okay. You can scroll down, go to the Python code, and there is creating data frame. Scroll down. Somewhere it is written this struct type. Can you see? Here it is written, right? So it says here it create an RDD of tuples, create a schema represented by struct type, matching the structure, apply the schema. So struct type can be used in many places. Here they are creating an RDD, then applying the struct type and creating the data frame. What we did, we created a JSON with the struct type. Wherever you want to apply the schema, you can use a struct type actually. I'll show you, there is an example. So this is not that, this we are using only this thing, what you say, struct type. When you are using a named tuple, what you need to do is that, if you have an RDD, from this RDD, I can create a data frame. Right, I have an RDD. So right now we don't have an RDD, we have a JSON file. So from this RDD, if I create a data frame, either I can say apply a struct type or apply the named tuple, because RDD need to hold some schema if you want, right? So I can create a named tuple and say that, hey, just convert into a data frame. It will create a data frame. I'll show you that. Okay. Now, are these queries familiar to you? Like how to access a column, because I don't know whether you have seen this in Python data frame. Like you want to access a column, you simply say df age, so that's a column age. And if you call the type on this age data frame, this age column, it says PySpark SQL column. So this is the column type that we want. And you can also select individual columns. So you can say df.select age, and you always do a show thing, show. So when you want to see the output in a data frame, you have to always say show. There is no collect. Collect will give you the underlying RDD. That's a different thing. Okay. So here in your notebook, it's df.select age, right? That won't show you anything. But you say dot show, you can see that column or whatever is that data frame contains. Show will show you the first 20 rows. Show argument will show you the first 20 rows. These are similar to Python. Okay. You have a Python data frame commands, right? Very similar to that. But there also you have filter, then you have group, join kind of operations, right? Very similar to that. Similar commands only. It is similar. Some commands are slightly different. Like you don't have this show command there, yeah. For sure. Yeah, show command, because you don't see something in Python. It's not like this. Here we have a data frame. So anything that is there in a data frame you want to see, you have to say dot show. And it'll show the first 20 rows, ideally. Python, like something else will be there.
No, but it's just you type it and you just...
It'll show. Yeah. You don't have to say show. Yeah. Because here everything is stored internally as a data frame. So if I simply say df.select, okay, it will have the age, right? But it'll just get stored as a temporary, data frame. I have to say dot show to see anything in a data frame, actually. Okay. You can also say the type of age. This again, you will have a data frame. So look at here. So when you do this, right, I can store it as a different data frame. I can say Raghu equal to this. Raghu equal to df.select age, which means you can select a column and so store it as something called a Raghu. Now Raghu will become a data frame, actually. Okay. And if I want, I can say Raghu dot show here. So any operation you do on a data frame will result in another data frame, and you can save it if you want, like Raghu this way. If you don't want to save it, that's also fine, right? And that is what we ran here, type df.select. I'll just remove this so that we don't confuse it. So type is actually a PySpark SQL data frame, and here you have the same show command, right? You can see what is inside this. And then there are some head command. For example, head will actually give you a list of row objects, right? So this is important in one way, because if I do a, where is it? Head 2, okay? Head 2 command will give me the first two rows from the data frame and see what it is. It is a row object. This is your data. This is row. ROW, row object. So you can actually see that it is storing the data as a row object. It is not storing like a text file or anything. It's actually an object. Okay, this is called the row object. So head will give you individual row objects from the data frame. You can also do this, and they say show, same thing you will get, no difference at all. Now you can also create new columns. For example, you can say with column new age. So if I run this, right, I am saying that df dot with column, I am saying new age, comma, there's a dfh dot show. So you are adding a column called new age, right? So any idea how these values came in the new age column? So you are saying that I want to create a new column called new age column, okay, where it is just a, reflection of the same column, but you can modify that also. You can say I want to add values or something, and this will create another data frame here. And if I do a df dot show, the difference is your original data frame will remain unchanged, because very much like RDDs, data frames are also immutable. So this could have created a temporary data frame in your session as of now, right? You can also rename if you want, df dot with column rename. There is an argument called with column renamed. You can say age super new age, something like that. So you are renaming this column basically. More complicated operations to create new columns. I mean, here all you're doing is that you're creating a new column, you are referring to the original column, and then you're multiplying by 2, adding 1, dividing by 2, and like that you are creating new columns, right? So I hope these things are very clear. Now the important thing is, how do you use SQL? So I will show you another use case where we will be running some queries using Python. As of now, we have not ran any queries. The important thing is that how do you use SQL? So this is not a table. So far what we were writing is just a data frame. If you want to use SQL, you have to use something called create or replace temporary view. You're actually creating a temp table. See, you have to say df dot create or replace temp view people. What this command will do, it will create a temporary table called people, and then if you want to run SQL queries, it is like this. If you no, very much. See, what am I doing here? I create a temporary table called people. This name can be anything. And this temporary table will register with Hive. It's a temporary table. If you exit, it will be gone. Okay. Once you have this table, if you want to run SQL query, simply say spark.sql, whatever query you want. Right? But again, I'm storing it as a data frame. And if I do a show, I can see here. So this spark is spark session object. You say spark.sql, any query, it will run on that table. Got it? But if you exit this shell, this table will be gone, because it's a temp table, it's not a permanent table. If you want a permanent table, there is a command called save as table. If you use save as table, by default it will go to Hive, okay? Or if you want to dump it into a RDBMS or something, you can create a connection, then you say save as table, it will go to the RDBMS. That is also possible, right? I'll show you how to save it in a Hive table. But now any SQL query you can run here, any SQL query that you want, regular SQL you can run. The results are always a data frame. You get a data frame as a result, right? Okay, great. And we will run this later, this filter approach and all, we will do it later, okay? And what are we trying to do? We will create an RDD. From the RDD, we'll create a data frame. We'll create an RDD. From the RDD, we'll create a data frame. Sometimes that is required. Now, there are two ways to do this. One way is that I have an RDD, right? This is RDD. So, let's say this is RDD. Each row, I will convert to a row object. So, this is normal RDD lines. I can say that convert each line into something called a row object. And once, so this is a raw object now. Then I use a method called create data frame, it will create it. This is first method. Second method is that I have again the RDD, okay? And I'll have lot of lines in the RDD. I will use my struct here. So we used struct type previously, that was for the JSON data. We directly read a JSON. On the RDD also, I can say I have an RDD with 10 lines, okay? I will create struct, I will say the I'll split it using comma. First column is integer type, second is string, third is something. Then I'll say create a data frame. So both ways you can do actually. First update is that each row I have to convert to a row object. And while creating this row object, I have to mention the data type. So I will say in the row object, first column is integer, second column is blah, blah, blah. Then I'll say create a data frame. Here what I will do, I don't have to create row object here. I'll create the struct type schema. Okay. So normally if you have simple RDDs, this is the way we do it, this row object. If you have nested structures and all, then struct type will be better because it can define so many columns internally. These two things we are going to do actually using this file we have, right? Schema inference example, right? So here we are creating SC, right? So what we are doing is we are saying that read the people.txt into an RDD called lines. Lines is an RDD, it's not a data frame. Remember the sc.txt file? And you can actually look at the data also. I think the cluster is a bit slow today. Yeah. So when you do a top three, it is showing you the top three elements of the RDD. We have Michael, Justin, Andy. You can also do a take two. Okay. So it is working, right? So are you able to read it, the data? Read, right? And now look at what I'm doing. I will first create an RDD called parts. And in parts, I will simply say lines.map. I will just say that take every line and split using comma. So how my data will look like? My data will look like this because each line I am splitting Michael, then 29, Justin, then 19, whatever I have. So first I am just splitting my data using comma. Okay. And then I will say dot map. I will say take every element and convert to a row object. This ROW is a row object. And then I'm saying that the name should be of the column should be name, and this should be integer. AH should be integer. And if I do a top two now, your data is now converted into row object, right? So here you are converting it. You are saying that map the data, okay? Take every entry from here, okay? Convert that into a row object, okay? And the first part will become name. Second part will become, age, right? Name and age. So P0, P1, both will become. And then if I do a people.top2 or take2, you can see there are two row objects now. This is one way of doing it, okay? And now this is useless to us now because it's a row object. You can't do anything. Now you will say create a data frame from this. So it'll simply add it as a data frame, these two lines. So when you do a dayof.show, it comes like this only. Like it is probably alphabetical order, A and N, right? So, but you're just looking at the data, right? The operations may not matter. For example, if I say count the age or something, it is going to work only on the age column. But the display will be on this manner. That is one thing that is specific to this thing, Spark SQL. And you will say spark.create data frame people. So this is the method. Create data frame is the method that you will use if you want to create a data frame from an RDD. This is very important. Create data frame is the method which will take this people. This is people, right? People RDD, and then create this data frame. So this schema people is your data frame now. Can you do a schema people.show? It is not there in the slide. Do a schema people.show. What we did, we read a text file into an RDD. Now the question is that how do you convert your RDD to a data frame? One way is this. One way is that you split each row into different column, and then you say this is my schema, and you convert that into row object, right? So this is where you have the row object, right? This people is actually row object. See, row. Once you have the people thing, okay, you will say create data frame, pass this people. This is one way. Now if you have much more complex data type, then you can use the struct type. Struct type also, there is an example if you scroll down. So here you can see this thing came, and you can also register it as a temporary table and then run the SQL queries. right? So this part is fine. You can, I will ask you to run that later. Now, programmatic schema example for complex nested schema, right? Here, look at what I'm doing. Again, I'm reading this people.txt. I will again say split it using comma, okay? And I will say that parts.map lambda. I will just extract the first column and second column. So I'll run this first, okay? So if you look at the data is now like Michael 29 and D30. Same data we have. But the only difference is you can also define the schema as a struct type. So I will say the schema is struct type where I have a name column of string and an age column of string. And same thing you are doing. You are saying that spark.create data frame, you will pass the RDD, you will also pass the schema. So two ways. One way is that either you manually convert to raw object and say create a data frame. Second way is that don't convert to raw object. Define your schema in struct type, say create data frame, give the RDD, give the schema, it will merge.